Hello, I would like to welcome you to the webinar about hydrogenation in pressure reactors. My name is Christian Weidmann. I'm the product manager of the BPC2 gas dosing system at Büchi AG. Today we will have a look at how gas dosing is done under pressure into a pressure reactor. Let's have a look back at how gas dosing under pressure has been done in the past. For a long time, the only way to do this was via a pressure bottle, as you see on the picture. It's a cheap and simple way of supplying gas into a pressure reactor. And it's actually this process of filling a pressure bottle, then depleting the pressure bottle into the reactor and measuring the pressure difference. That idea that triggered the development of the PPC system. The idea was, why not automate this? We also have seen the development of other methods of gas dosing. An important one is by using a mass flow controller. Unlike the above system with a pressure bottle, it allows for continuous dosing and it allows control and measurement of the flow rate and the sum of the gas. Unfortunately, it requires quite some electronics and software to make it work in a simple way. In pressure application, also you require a shutoff valve. Or summarized, you need some extra hardened software to make it work as a system. And we have some technological disadvantages, like the susceptibility to vibrations and contamination, and a limited turndown ratio, which means the lowest to the highest flow rate. That range is somehow limited and often a limitation in bigger pressure vessels. Facing the limitations mentioned and looking out for better solutions for our customers, the engineers at Büchi wanted to build a system that would abolish limitations of dosing by pressure vessel or mass flow controller. So the BPC2 was born. It's an all-in-one system. Just two input lines for nitrogen and hydrogen. It includes simple automation features. It's built on a proven dosing system with volumetric dosing. It's combinable with most of the Büchi reactors, from small glass reactors up to liter size high pressure vessels. It includes a very extensive safety concept. It has an unmatched flow rate because even with one pulse you have accurate dosing. And of course it includes data logging and includes a lot of flexibility regarding connectivity. Today we will use a polyclave pressure reactor. It's equipped with a 1 liter glass vessel. It's equipped with a magnetic coupling and a stirrer that we call Cyclone 300. And it's equipped with various instruments on the top. The instruments we use for the stirrer is the Cyclone controller. Then we have our main piece, what we look at today. That's the BPC2. It consists of the gas dosing unit and the controller. When we look at the schematic diagram of the BPC2, we see the inert gas input, which is used for filling the reactor and purging the reactor and the BPC2 with inert gas, usually nitrogen or argon. The other line we see is the active gas input, which first goes through this big blue wheel, which is a TESCOM pressure regulator. Then it goes into what we call the volumetric dosing block. both of those inputs go to one output, so this is this one connection to the reactor. When we look into the BPC2 dosing unit, we see this red block, that's our volumetric dosing. It's nothing else than a block with two valves, a small volume, pressure sensors, which are actually high quality, high precision digital pressure sensors, temperature sensor, and nothing else. The BPC2 does the actual dosing in small pulses. It's like filling a small pressure bottle of 2 milliliters and releasing the pressure into the reactor at the rate of 2.5 times per second. For each filling and dosing cycle, the system calculates the amount of gas by means of the volume, temperature, and pressure. And it does that using the groundworks laid by Mr. van der Maals and Mr. Lemon, which most of you would probably know from school. Okay, we have opened now our reactor and we will fill in some liquid. In this case, it's just colored water for you, for the video. So this would be our chemical ingredients. So that's enough. Now we have loaded our reactor with some blue water, which represent our chemicals. We have loaded some catalyst into the catalyst basket, and now we are ready to close the reactor. This unit is equipped with a fast action closure, very simple and efficient to use. It's closed now, and as a safety feature, we have this valve here. Now the mechanism is locked. You cannot open the vessel anymore unless you open the safety valve. Now, before we actually start manipulating anything on the pressure side, let's think about the safety features. First of all, I have to check myself. Am I prepared? Am I equipped with safety glasses if it's under real pressure conditions? Do I know the reaction I have? Do I know what happens when I add gas to the reactor? Is my vessel in a good state? Is everything tight? Do I understand what happens when I manipulate here? Actually, the BPC2 comes with an extensive introduction and a chapter about safety, so you really have to read that chapter. Once you have done all this, we can start adding pressure. So the input is already open. I can set the regulator pressure. I can read it here. So I set this now, let's say 10 bar. So the gas supply is already open. We have two hoses here. One is connected to the input port for the active gas. The other one is connected to the input port of the inert gas. And the output of the BPC2 is connected via a pressure hose to the input port of the pressure reactor. So now it's time to start dosing, or actually preparing the system for the first steps. First of all, I checked one of the safety features, which is the pressure, because I have a 6 bar pressure vessel. It must not have more than 6 bar in here. The BPC2 unit is capable of supplying, in this case, 60 bars, which I do not apply, but anyway. So I will limit the pressure to 6 bar, just to make sure I will never have more than 6 bar supplied into the reactor. Now we start opening the regulator pressure. That's the input to the system. We can see that regulator pressure here. This, of course, has to go higher than the 6 bars I want to supply. So I will set this to about 10, 11 bar. It's not really critical. By the way, if I'm too high, I can just reduce the pressure and you might hear the noise of the gas going out that exhaust port, which usually also has to be connected to some exhaust line. Now you will see how I do manipulate various values on the controller. And just to give you a brief idea, the controller consists of a section which shows the values. It has another section where I select the menus, where we have the three main menus, prepare our reaction, which means purge and venting. We have our process where we actually add the gas to the reactor, and we have what we call sequences, that's semi-automated process for purging and leak testing. So we will go through this now. First of all, we must do a leak test to make sure the reactor is tight. And to do that, I have prepared the first sequence. It does a leak test at 2.8 bar with nitrogen. It will wait for 30 seconds. Then it has a specific value that is allowed. If the pressure drops more than that value, it will alarm us. When we finish the leak test successfully, we have a purge cycle, which we have set to 3 times. You can set it to the number of times you require by your instruction. And purge pressure will change between 2.8 and 1 bar. So I will start that now. So you'd hear the gas going in. The reactor is now at 2.9 bar. It will wait a few seconds. So now it's doing the leak test. Each step is indicated here on the display, so you always see what the system is doing. You also see when something goes wrong. In this case, we are fine. Now you hear the first cycle. Pressure was reduced, now it's going up again. Now, pressure is reduced. Now the sequence is finished, which means the reactor is now filled with nitrogen at about 1 bar and it's cleaned. There will be no more oxygen in the system, which means we are now ready for the next step. We can do the very same process with active gas to fill the reactor with active gas if that is required, or we can go straight to preparing the reactor at the working pressure. So I should suggest we just go to the working pressure. Let's say for the demonstration, we want to have 2 bars in the reactor. And we will add now the active gas into the reactor. The noise you have heard is the typical noise of the BPC2. You hear the pulsing in this volumetric dosing system. Each pulse is measured very precisely, so we know how much gas that is in it. But now we are still in the preparation phase, so you see the gas consumption is still zero. The next step will be a leak test at working pressure. In this case, I have set the system to 3 bar, and I would like to do that leak test with hydrogen at 3 bar. Again, we can do this in a semi-automated way. So we have set the leak test level at 3 bar. It will wait for 30 seconds before we actually start the leak test for another 30 seconds. What you can hear now, the system is loading the reactor up to 3 bar to prepare for the leak test. Now we have reached the 3 bar of the leak test. You see the time counting until it's ready to actually check whether there's a leak or not. So the leak test passed as expected. That's why we have tight Büchi reactors. It's easy to reach that state. Now we are ready to actually start the chemical process. For example, this hydrogenation. At the end, when you have done your chemical reaction, you want to have all the data. You want to know what happened. And that's another nice feature of the BPC2. You can do data logging straight on the BPC2. So we have a pressure reactor here that's being logged. We have a temperature probe here that's being recorded. We have a speed probe here that can be recorded as well. And we have options where you can add other values as well that come in with an analog signal. That's already prepared. What I do, I add the memory stick, go into the data logging menu, I can give it a name, which I already did, and I will do the recording once per second. I start the data logging, I see the icon is now on green, which means I'm ready to do the actual process now. Now you see the gas consumption is still on zero, which means all the gas we have added so far did not count because it's not part of the process. Now we are actually ready to do the reaction, which means everything is in the reactor. Now we have to add the two most important ingredients for the reaction. That's temperature and stirring. The temperature we do not simulate now because it's just a demonstration, but the stirrer we will start. Before I actually turn it on, this is a gassing stirrer, which means it's a hollow shaft and the gas is being drawn into the liquid. You can see that once we start it up. Now we start the stirring. And you can see the bubbles. That's thanks to the hollow shaft, which draws the gas into the stirrer and creates a good mix of the gas and the liquid. We are now ready for the dosing, and we have started data logging, which means from now on, all the gas added to the reaction will be counted to the reaction. Now we are already at 3 bar, which means when I start dosing, I will have maybe a few small pulses, but now the reaction starts. I will simulate this by creating a small leak. And now you hear the gas dosing of the BPC. To see what happened, I have a second view on the instruments, which is called the graph view, which gives you an idea of the process. You can see the graph here. To explain more, I will switch back to the numeric view and I will actually increase the gas consumption. You hear now it's almost at the top. We have a flow rate of 2.5 liters per minute. Now, in case of an exothermal reaction, I might want to reduce that flow rate. And so I can go in and say flow rate and limit. Now I set the flow rate to 1 liter per minute, which is about half. And you see the flow rate is at 1 liter and the pressure will drop. Now what do I do if I don't want the pressure to drop? If I want to increase the flow rate, I can just go in and change the parameters, let's say to 1.5 liters per minute. And you hear we have a few more click. And here the flow rate goes to 1.5. And when I now decrease the pressure consumption or simulate the decrease, the pressure will now go up again to 3 bar. We have different flow modes. One is just for pressure. If you just limit pressure, the system will dose as quickly as possible until it has reached the pressure. Or we have, in this case, flow rate control with pressure limit. So the 3 bars will always be the limit. But to reach the 3 bar, the system tries to follow this 1.5 liters per minute. And now you also see we have added about 4 norm liters of hydrogen into the reactor. Now let's consider now, we want to take a sample. We don't actually take the sample, but we will stop and we will release some of the gas, because this is what will happen when you take out some of your sample through a pressurized sampling system. Now you want to restart the reaction, or maybe even you stop the stirrer. The reaction has stopped and now you want to continue the reaction. First you want to load the reactor to 3 bar, and you see we have this charge function. So it goes up to 3 bar without counting that gas. Now we have reached, we go to dose, we start the stirrer. Now the reaction will start again and gas consumption will be counted again. All this you can see either on the graph or you can have a look at it later on. All the data is on the memory stick. Our reaction is finished now and we want to save the data. So we stop data logging. Now we can remove the memory stick and bring that to the computer. It's a CSV file, so you can open it in Excel and do with it whatever you want. Additionally, I would like to show you an overview of the safety features. First of all, we have a limit of the gas consumption. So if you have a reaction that takes a long time and you know about how much gas it should use, you can set that limit plus a margin, and if something goes wrong, like a leak or something like that, it will stop at that limit. Or you can say if the process is finished and it will not deliver any more gas, it will automatically stop after a certain time. In this case, it's preset to 120 minutes. So if no more gas is delivered after 2 hours, it will stop automatically. We have already looked at the pressure limit, another safety feature. In this case, it's set to 6 bar for the reaction and 2.8 bar for the inert gas. We have leak monitoring. So if for any reason the pressure drops suddenly, for example, due to the break of the bursting disk, it will also stop the system. So this is set to, if the pressure drops to 70% within 1 second, it's considered a leak and not part of the process, and the system will stop. We also have what is called backflow prevention. So if we deliver gas, the pressure on the gas delivery always has to be higher than on the reactor, which is obvious. But if for any reason something goes wrong, or for example, if the bottle is empty, you will have a backflow, and that backflow is prevented by the software. Another feature, which is actually a very important one with inflammable gases, there is a built-in gas sensor, and you see that little flame here. So if there is any leakage gas detected in the dosing unit, it will automatically switch off and go to a safe position. Now we are at the end of our simulated hydrogenation in our pressure reactor. The BPC too is capable of more than that. First of all, it's available in different pressure ranges from 12 bar to 400 bar. And also, it can be used for other gases than hydrogen. It's available for ethylene, propylene, carbon monoxide, and carbon dioxide. It also has different options on connectivity to be connected to different systems. It can also be included into automation systems. I hope I was able to give you an overview of the capabilities of this product. If you have more questions, don't hesitate to contact us or go to our website at buchiglas.com. Thank you for your attention.